Calgary podcast.
Oh yeah. All right, people. Welcome to Creative Theory Podcast, a show that brings you conversations with visual artists about how they got to where they got, what their day-to-day is like, what their struggles are, their goals, thoughts on the art world, and a lot more. Today we got a very special artist in here, illustrator, I would say. I think we'll have to figure out which one to call him, but we'll find out soon. Our guest designs for print while maintaining an active illustration practice, and which includes branding, promotional pieces, editorial work, publication design. But I would say more importantly, he's a creator and owner of the Bummer Club, which I definitely want to get into. Also known as Combo, I don't know why, but Michael Mateyko, welcome. Thanks for joining the show.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so let's get into that first. Why Combo?
So
how do you say there's an H at the end?
There's an H at the end. The first reason why it's called Combo is because at the time it was the only result on Google, so we made up a word. When I graduated from art college in 2009, right. I actually worked with a good friend of mine, Hans Thiessen, who actually lives here now. He's
here in Vancouver.
Yeah, he's a creative director at Rethink, so he moved on up in the world, leaving us all behind. But we decided very arrogantly, I think, that we were going to start a design agency almost immediately.
Right after school?
With no experience whatsoever, no client base, no money, no budget. So we designed a whole brand around it. It was very, Germanic and very, you know, it used DIN and a whole bunch of interstate typefaces. And I just never let go of it. It sort of just became this creative alter ego for me. He's not part of it anymore just because he's busy. He's got a real life with a real wife and real children and a real job. But I just kept it going because it seemed like the right thing to do. And I think it's been really helpful for me, actually, just to have something to hide behind.
Just enable. Well, I like that you're dreaming big, first of all.
Yeah.
Gotta go hard. But so Combo is, that's a name for, you would say, like the studio, the branding for yourself now?
Yeah. Kind of strangely, not everybody seems to realize that it's just one guy. It's just me. It's like a one-man tag team.
You do make a lot of work and it's varied.
Oh, yeah. I try to do as much as I can. But I get requests for internships from all over the world because they think I'm like a real company. You know, people in Spain or Portugal or whatever, which I appreciate. I think it's very flattering. But I always have to tell them, like, the only thing you can do is just, if you want to live in my basement and just, like, help sweep up now and again, there's, like, not much work for you.
I think that's how you know you made it, though.
That's how I know that.
People asking you for internships is good.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah, that's one criteria for success, for sure.
But you said, so Combo, it has no meaning. It's just, you just found a word that had no results.
Combo was supposed to be a combination of two people, Hans and me. He put a K in front for some reason. I guess he liked Mortal Kombat. There's an M in it because of Michael, and there's an H in it because of Hans. And that's it. It's not a lot going on
there. Okay, it's
actually
pretty deep. Very nice.
Yeah, you're right. It is.
Awesome. And one thing I've noticed, when I was trying to do a little bit of research on you, and actually after that you emailed me some images, I feel like you don't post all of your work, and you're so freaking good and you have so much good work. But for example, you know, if I go on your Instagram, I feel like I don't think I've seen, like, the stuff that you emailed me, I don't think I've seen those on your Instagram. But I don't know why. I think you should be posting that stuff.
It's I try to do as much work as I can. I think I've been a little lazy in the last couple months, but some of the things I was sending you were very personal projects. Some of those images, those like very thin line drawings, for instance, are not on my site just because I haven't gotten around to it yet. I'm actually getting a book done in Singapore right now.
What?
Right. So there's a risograph studio that I met here about a year and a half ago called Knuckles and Notch. They publish a whole bunch of crazy art stuff in Singapore, which is really hard to find in that country. Mm-hmm. And I'm Singaporean, so yep. For me there's like a camaraderie there, I suppose. And we were looking for a project to do for a long time, and I was very depressed last year, and I did about 100 drawings, and I compiled them into a book, and I think it's finally getting made this month, which I'm very excited about.
Is it just by you, or is it going to be other artists?
It's just me. It's like a bizarre comic narrative that doesn't really make a lot of sense, but it was all these cathartic drawings I was making. It's just like
the same line once you're talking.
Yeah,
about.
It's just like a big hand crushing this guy over and over and over again, and I don't really understand it, but I'm happy to be making it.
You're just expressing yourself onto it.
Yeah, you
letting
know,
the depression speak. Is that what
you're saying? I feel like everybody feels that way sometimes. You know, there's like a big hand just like pushing their face in. from time to time.
Yeah, I can relate. Is this book going to appear anywhere else outside of Singapore?
I think they're making a small limited run because of the way the book is designed, and because of the way risograph works, because the paper kind of shifts and judders when you're printing, they have to hand cut every single page.
You have to explain risograph. Is it like the way of printing?
Yes, risograph is a way of printing that I think was originally intended for church pamphlets, I suppose. It's like a large photocopier that prints in drums of color. It's like a very, very, very cheap way of reproducing in a similar manner of screen printing, I suppose.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was going to say. It sounds like similar to screen printing.
Yeah, yeah, there's a couple of places in town that do it as well. There's Moniker Press, run by a girl named Erica here in Vancouver, and I've worked with her a couple of times. She's really great. But this is a great opportunity to sort of put something together. And it's a process where you don't have a whole lot of control over the outcome. The printing always... Each run is always a little bit different. There's always flaws. There's always errors in it. And I think that's part of the charm, you know?
Definitely. That's why it sounds so cool. Is that almost, it's like, feels like it's going to be handmade, even though it's not.
Yeah, well, in this case, it actually is. Oh, it is. They're being forced to hand cut every single page of every single book, which is way too much work, but I appreciate their faith in me.
Okay, and in this case, this partnership, are you paying for the cost of creating this?
Or? No, they are publishing it. Okay. Which means that they're taking on all the costs, which is very, very generous of them. Yeah, and I'm getting, I think, 50%, something like that.
Once again, is this how we know you made it?
I don't think that's true. I don't know. I want to be on the front page of Google. That's when you know you made it.
Front page of Google?
Okay. Yeah.
Like, where you mean the letter?
Yeah, the Google Doodle, man. That's the dream, isn't
Meaning
it?
Meaning it's about you or you drew it?
That's a good question. One of both. I don't know.
I think it's going to be...
Aim high.
Yeah. There you go. Just like the same mentality that you started out of school. Just got to keep going. Yeah.
Yeah. Extreme arrogance. Right. Yeah.
Oh, you seem pretty humble.
I'm trying.
Nice. So the book sounds really cool. Let me see. How did we get there? Oh yeah. Posting all the artwork. But so it wasn't a conscious choice not to post some of the work. It's just time.
I am just a poor social media manager, I think, is the real issue there.
That's okay. As long as you're producing, that seems to be more important.
I think that is quite a bit more important. Yeah.
Okay. And then when you're saying that, you're busy making work, how many hours a day do you work?
It really does depend. I know that's not a very satisfying answer.
I never count, but I guess it's easier with a full-time job. But for personal work, it's not like sitting there clicking a timer and go.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I think for me, my issue is that I work in bursts, so there'll be like a week that goes by where I don't feel it. For instance, I'm not talking about commercial work. I'm talking purely about my personal practice here. But if a week goes by and I'm just like sitting in bed playing video games for 8 hours, that's okay. As long as you make up for it the next week, as long as you're working till 5 a.m. every single day, jamming on an idea, trying to get something done. Do you know what I mean?
It sounds like a lot of pressure too.
Is it?
Meaning that if you're skipping a week, but you're putting the pressure on yourself for next week to work extra hard.
I think that's okay. I think that you kind of need that pressure sometimes.
I guess so, yeah.
You know, it's like when you have an idea in your head and you need the pressure to actually make it, so you go tell someone about it, and now you're gonna be embarrassed if you don't actually do it, so now you have to do it.
That's true. But that sounds like pressure, but maybe if you just manage with it really well.
Maybe. I mean, I just think that it's a very natural way of working for me. Mm-hmm. Like, there are times, even this week, when I was just up till, 3 in the morning, and that's fine. I don't think it's a problem. I don't have anybody yelling at me in the morning to get up and go to work. As long as I'm hitting on my deadlines for my professional career, I don't think it really matters that much.
Is this how you would sell freelance work to people? I get to work?
I think the reason I would sell freelance to people is simply that you don't have to commute anywhere.
Yeah. Oh, that's a nice bonus.
It's a huge... Well, I mean, I'm also from Alberta, where you had to drive in the snow for hours every day to get to your job. And being able to wake up and just, like, roll out of bed and watch people try to dig their cars out while you're just, like...
having your coffee.
Enjoying a hot chocolate and just staring at them, I think is worth its weight in gold.
You know, but it's surprising, then, that you're in Vancouver. You could be in Hawaii right now.
That's true. That's something I thought about. I actually thought about... So I moved here about 2 years ago, and at the time I was deciding where I should live and what I should do, because it kind of doesn't matter anymore, time zones do affect how you handle freelance, especially for tight turnarounds on advertising or editorial work or anything like that. But I was thinking about living in Singapore, but it's a bit complicated because of my own personal history there. But Vancouver is a really fun, vibrant city. It doesn't have winter. The food here is extremely good. People here are really chill. A lot of my friends moved out here, you know.
I love that you say it doesn't have winter, but this is, it's only true because it's coming from a person who experienced real winter in Alberta.
Yeah.
If you ask people here, they know the winter and it's a lot of rain.
Whatever. That's cool. I don't have to go outside if I don't want to.
Totally. And actually, well, just to clarify, because I sometimes I don't do these intros really well. We are in Vancouver, Canada, BC, on Hastings Street at Savon Meats, right in front booth, Savon Radio. Mm. Just if you're, in case you're that person listening outside of here, I should probably do a better intro. You mentioned Alberta. I think before we get into more of your freelance work and the life balance part of our conversation, I wanted to maybe get a kind of brief history of you and the art education that you got or how you got into art.
Sure. So the cliff notes of my life are I was born in Singapore, and in my youth I lived in Indonesia and Malaysia on Borneo for a couple of years. But primarily I'm actually from Alberta. I spent about 27 years living in Calgary, which is, I think, a wonderful city, but it doesn't have exactly the most vibrant art scene. Not because the people aren't working hard or aren't any good, because they certainly are. It's just that the culture there doesn't support it in the ways that I think that, for instance, Vancouver might. And in a grander sense, there's just no industry to support it, you know? So originally, as I was mentioning in our conversation before we stepped into the booth, I was actually an engineering student. And I picked that out of a hat, basically, because I was math inclined and I really enjoyed all the work I was doing in high school in that field. I didn't draw anything. I didn't know what I was doing. I was, you know, 17 years old, having to decide the rest of my life. And I went to the University of Calgary for 2 years in their engineering school. And for a variety of life reasons, for instance, you know, my parents got divorced and like a grandparent passed away, and I was just really lost in life, as I think a lot of young people are. You know, I was like 18 and I had no idea what was going on. I just stopped going to my classes one day. I don't really know why, but I didn't go to my midterms, my finals, and very unsurprisingly, I was kicked out of school. And I spent about a year just doing nothing. I was like walking dogs. I was trying to make weird art stuff on my computer at home. But I didn't really have a direction in life, and out of necessity, I had to go back to school to, you know, get my parents off my back, which is like a very unceremonious way of putting this whole career, I suppose, but it's truthful.
You're being very honest. I just pushed into art.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't really know what I was doing, but I did know that I enjoyed making pictures. That doesn't mean drawing, but I enjoyed making pictures. I was learning how to do a little bit of 3D work here and there.
But you didn't find that out right away. It sounds like that's when you found out you liked it, right?
Yeah, I think that for me it was an escape from the life I was leading, which was not very glamorous at the time. And eventually I applied to ACAD, which is the Alberta College of Art Design, which is in Calgary. And I applied with a portfolio that had no drawings in it because I didn't know how to draw and I didn't want to draw, and it was such a foreign idea to me that someone could make a living or try to, even beyond making a living, just, I didn't know anybody who did it. You know, it seemed as strange to me as panning for gold. It was just a thing that people didn't actually do. It was, you saw it in movies. I applied, and eventually they relented and let me in for reasons unknown. And I was very, very fortunate that I met a whole lot of wonderful people there who were really passionate and infectious, and they really didn't necessarily teach me how to draw, you know, per se, but I think that they're it was like a very invigorating environment to be in, you know.
It must have been so cool finding your own group when you're saying, if there's not a lot of culture in Calgary, and then you go to this one place where everyone is basically seeking it out, right?
It's so strange thinking back on it now, because I wasn't exposed to any of this growing up, you know? I don't have any family members who were into art. I didn't really have any friends who were into it at the time either. And all of a sudden, you're surrounded by all these people who also want to be making pictures, and they're also excited about it in all sorts of different ways, you know, painters, people who are working in sculpture or in, like, digital art. And I found it really to be the thing that kind of put me back on track, I suppose, in a way, because my life was to be fair, really off the rails.
It sounds like, I mean, unfortunately with the parents and like family, which is, yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
elements pulling apart.
Yeah, I mean, things happen. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not unheard of, and certainly I know plenty of other people who've had similar kind of experiences. Mm-hmm. And I found that it was, going to that school at that time, irrespective of the kind of instruction I had or the program or anything else, I think that just the environment and being surrounded by supportive people was yeah. valuable.
And finally seeing the like-minded people. I feel like in that kind of, not adversity, but in that kind of environment, you're probably more likely to cling to one another.
I think so as well, yeah. I think that's something that is actually a very important point to make about the art community in Alberta, at least my own observations of it, which admittedly is a small slice of the whole, mm-hmm. is that I think because you so rarely find people who are involved in the arts, who are supportive of it, that you make friends very easily. You know, the community clings together, and mm-hmm. it's very scrappy, and they fight really hard for what they have. And it's something I really admire. I think it's something that is not easy to find out there in the world, you know?
Mm-hmm. Would you say, is it possible for a lack of art scene to make better artists?
I think that it creates an environment where the people who are invested in it are doing so in the face of adversity.
Yeah.
And in doing so, they have to become more invested in it, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
There's no, for instance, in Vancouver, at least, you know, again, this is only the observation of one person who's really not in that field. But, you know, there's a large animation industry here. There's film, there's games. If you go to a school here, you can get a job. It's like a very straightforward thing. You just apply, and then all of a sudden you're working, you're drawing, and you're involved in the industry. But in Alberta, like, if you want to make games, and you don't want to leave Alberta, you got to do everything yourself.
Wow, yeah.
You know, you have to do everything. And I think that requires a certain kind of personality type.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that I quite admire. But at the same time, it also means that a lot of people, they just get pushed out before they can get started. And that's really unfortunate.
You're saying the people who probably could have been in the art field, but just the circumstance and the
I think, again, it's an issue of selection bias when you see people come out of it and become successful. There are a huge number of people who came out of ACAT who are phenomenal artists,
mm-hmm.
not just in my year, but other people. For instance, we were talking about Ed Kwong in Montreal, or Joy Ng, who I think is in Seattle now. Even Jeff McFetridge, who's like quite a famous graphic designer. He went to ACAT for a number of years. I don't know. It's like a very strange school.
Do you have an explanation for that? Because previously before we started, we also talked about, and from my perspective, the amount of not just like, oh, good artists, like amazing artists that I've met that came from ACAT, it's very impressive. And then like you're part of that group. But like you're saying, I'm only seeing the people, I guess, that have succeeded. That's what you mentioned, right?
Yeah, I think the other people who for whatever reason, you know, largely not for lack of trying or mm-hmm. for ability or talent, you know, maybe it's personal reasons. Maybe this is just within the lifestyle they're interested in.
Yeah.
You know, you don't get to talk to them. You don't get to see them just because we're not in that city.
Mm-hmm.
Which is unfortunate. I mean, I think that there are a lot of people that I knew who had plenty of potential, who could have done, I think, really amazing things. But the environment was supportive in the way that it might have had to have been for them to succeed.
Mm-hmm. It's such a other element to think about when you're saying like the availability for work itself. And just because, like, if you were here, you know, kind of who knew if you've been a graphic designer, illustrator, or, you know, maybe a video game artist, or like you're saying, like, maybe you could have even gone into animation, but, yeah, the kind of circumstance, sometimes you don't even think about it, you know what I mean? Like, it's very easy to forget that all these other elements play into what your life could be like, even beyond the fact that you really want to be, you know, like, yeah, working as a rigger in games or something, but...
I think something that I talk about, because I've given a number of talks at the school over the years, even as recently as a couple of months ago, and one of the points I try to make to students that I was definitely not aware of when I was younger is that when you're young, you're sort of given this idea that you can pick a star in the sky and that can be you, you know? You can just be whatever you want to be, which I think is an important thing to hold on to as a dream.
Where is this going?
And I'm not trying to crush anybody's dreams here, but the reality is you need to be aware of what you need to get there.
Definitely.
You can certainly do it. I'm not going to tell anybody that they can't become the world's most famous artist or whatever it is you want to do. You want to be an astronaut, that's cool. You can do it.
Yeah.
but you have to understand that certain things need to be in place. You need to be in the right environment, you need to be supported in certain kinds of ways, and if not, you have to go find that support, you have to be diligent, you have to be hardworking. Yeah. I think the thing for me, for instance, is that I'm a freelancer, and I do enjoy the lifestyle, and I do think that it's something that I would have done eventually anyway, but in Calgary, if you want to draw for a living, that's mm-hmm. it. Where are you going to work? There's mm-hmm. There's nowhere to go. You have to be a freelancer.
Yeah. How was the first year of trying to find freelance work?
It was awful.
Yeah? Just how many emails have you sent out?
I do remember, well, just to sort of recap the history.
Yeah, please.
When I graduated in 2009, it was also the bottom of the housing bubble, which is really unfortunate. I was very lucky in that I had interned at a place called Critical Mass, which is a very large marketing design agency in Calgary, the previous summer. And I think just that that summer 2009 when I graduated, they had fired about 100 people.
Whoa.
It was pretty rough. And I mean, they lost a major client or two, and it's not, you know, often it's a political decision. They don't have a lot of control over it. I think I was the only hire they made that summer just because I was like tight with one of the creative directors there, and nice. he wanted to hire me, and I was very, very grateful. And after working there for not even a year, I just realized that working for a larger agency wasn't for me. And I ended up working at a smaller place called Juice Creative for about 2 years, which was, you know, fine. It was a very supportive environment. All the people there were super nice. It was very, very small.
Also out of Calgary.
Okay. There's only two creatives there, myself and its principal, Rick Thomas. And we were doing a lot of local work, and it was fine. I was happy to be there. But eventually I realized that I didn't really want to be working for other people in that way anymore. So I, without any plan whatsoever, decided to give my 2 weeks notice. I didn't know what I was doing. I did not have a client base lined up. I think most people who are freelancers, if they're smart about it, they try to line up about $30,000 worth of work first.
That's how much you have to? Okay.
I think that seems like a nice, healthy number, you know? Yeah. It seems like if you have like a $30,000 retainer, you can probably fill the gaps yourself, right? But I didn't do that. I quit, and the next day I realized I didn't have a job, and I didn't have any prospects, and I was rapidly running out of money. So what I did is I built a database of about 300 to 400 jobs that I was interested in.
Wow.
Which is something I should have done to school, embarrassingly enough. So for instance, it was like every single magazine I could find, every single online publication that I thought was interesting, any charitable organizations I thought could use illustration work. I used to go to a place called Globe Magazines, or rather I think it was called Globe News in Calgary, and I would just spend hours there like rifling through every single magazine, anything that had any illustration in it, you know, anything at all. I would just like annoy the clerk there and bring out a notepad and write down the names of the art director. You'd find the masthead and so on. I would like track them down on Twitter and like bug them. And that first year was very lean. It was like pretty rough, I must say.
How much work have you done that was for free?
In that year or in my lifetime?
In that year. No, yeah.
I think that I did, you know, honestly, probably not that much.
Not that much, okay.
Because usually I only work for free if the project is particularly interesting.
Yeah.
Or because it's like a charitable thing, or it's just a community I want to be part of or support.
Yeah. No, that's why I'm asking, because usually in the beginning, that's you end up putting a lot of those hours in.
Yeah, that's true. And that's, I mean, I think that's unfortunate, but the reality is that is often the case for myself, for many other people I know. They're working for free because they want, you know, this mythical exposure, which may or may not kill you, but they're doing their best to get their name out there and sort of have some practice.
The mythical exposure will kill you?
Yeah, you know, that's what they always say. You've died of exposure. That's what happens in Oregon Trail, right?
People say that.
It can happen. I was doing a lot of personal projects at the time as well. And actually, most of the work that I had in that first year was because I was doing markets at the time. I was like, there's an event in Calgary called Market Collective. And it's very similar to Eastside Flea here, right?
Okay, yeah.
So you just go there, you set up, you meet people, you sell some work.
Were you already selling prints at that point then? Is that what
I had a lot of, a fairly extensive catalog of work. None of it was particularly great, but, you know, looking back at it now. But I was selling it, and it was a lot of educational stuff because it's just what I was interested in. And I was very fortunate in that people were quite receptive to it. And, you know, if you're there, and in Alberta, there's really not that many people who are doing exactly, you know, the kind of graphic style that I was working at the time. So, you know, someone buys it, they put it in their office. Oh, hey, we need to, like, get some illustration work done. We're an ad agency, but I know this person because I met him at a market and so on, right?
That's awesome. That's really cool. How do you end up even doing that kind of graphic style so early on?
One of the reasons I went to art school, besides raw human desperation, was sort of an admiration for a particular design studio in the UK. I believe they're in Sheffield, maybe they're in Bristol, I'm not quite sure anymore. Mm-hmm. They're called the Designers Republic, and they are particularly known because they did all the branding for Wipeout, which is a video game series in the 90s. Okay. At least, you know, in my head, but they'd been around for a number of years doing a lot of really crazy experimental work. And that graphic style was just something that I thought was really fascinating. I don't really, I just like left an impression on my brain. It was something that I very poorly tried to emulate early on, even before I was doing any real drawing.
Really? Okay.
Again, as I mentioned in our conversation before this, I had never drawn a human being before in my life. And all of a sudden, you're in art school, and they put this like Conte in your hand, and they're just like, a girl takes her clothes off, and they're like, okay, draw her now.
That's actually how it happens.
It's very similar, yes. And I was just like, what am I doing with my life? What is everyone else? I was like sweating nervously. I'm seeing other people like making marks on the paper. I'm just trying to like look busy so nobody bothers me.
But were we thinking? Were we thinking, how am I going to use this to get a job kind of thing?
I was thinking, where is the class where I get to draw circles on a computer?
Okay, so you already kind of knew what you wanted to do, though, even at that point.
Yeah, I think so. I think that it was, I mean, in retrospect, I think taking those classes was necessary. It was not optional.
Oh, yeah.
It was something that
they're
think
there for a reason, though.
Yeah. Those foundational classes are, I think for me, they're frustrating because it wasn't a clear through line to what I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. But I think they were necessary and in a way that I didn't grasp early on.
And where did the work ethic come from? Because it sounds like, you know, you've never drawn, you go to school, you come out, and I know it's not like, oh, boom, and you're super amazing, but it seems like you picked up the skills that were necessary pretty quickly. And I mean, managed to freelance and still are. So there's like, where did that work ethic come from?
I think this is something I can credit to the school I was going to.
Yeah.
The program at the time is a little different than it is now, but it required an absurd amount of work. You know, I was there from 9 a.m. till 1 a.m. every single day, with essentially no exceptions for the first couple of years. It was really unfair, I think. Like, we were overworked to a degree that is not healthy.
Okay.
You know, people were dropping like flies, people were getting sick. If you talk to any of the people who are there in my year, Kyle Scott or Douglas Nung or these people, they'll corroborate my story. It was really unhealthy. but I do think that the thing that came out of that is a real sense of camaraderie.
That's what I was going to say. It must have been you and the guys who we know.
Yeah, and again, this is how I know them, because we were there in class for 12 hours a day, just like our brains are pouring out of our ears because we, you know, can't think straight anymore. But it's impossible not to make friends in that situation, I think.
Oh, yeah. For sure, yeah. Especially with like one common goal, and everyone's suffering.
Right, and to be to the point, the common goal is survival. We're all trying to make it to the end of the year. And I know it sounds kind of trite, but I do think that sort of ingrained in me a particular kind of work ethic.
And was that a 4-year program?
Yeah, it was a 4-year program for a Bachelor of Design, I believe.
Did you get art history in your school?
Yeah. ACAD is a very studio-based school. Mm-hmm. And by that I mean that almost all your classes are 8-hour studios.
Okay.
Again, I think that's changed now. I can't speak to the program as it is in 2018. But at the time, it was 8-hour studios. And whenever you had lunch, you probably had an art history class, which most people slept through, unfortunately. I think to their detriment. You know, there are a handful of humanities classes, but really it's a studio-based school. It's like taking a trade. It's like becoming an electrician, except you have a paintbrush in your hand.
I kind of feel like that's how it should be done, though. What do you think? I think it's so important to be making all the time, because that's what your life is going to be like, right?
I would agree. I think that the thing is, for the majority of people that I knew, especially at that age, you know, most people are quite young. They're just out of high school. They don't know what they're doing. They have an idea of what it's like to be an artist, and it's like a mythical idea, you know? The artist, for instance, is struck by inspiration from heaven, and all of a sudden, you know, the muse has occupied your body, and you just can't control, and you're just a conduit for the universe, and you're creating this amazing thing, and then you like lie down, you're sweating, you're like, wow, I did that amazing thing. Isn't that cool? Hey, guys, you know. Whereas, obviously, as you know, in reality, it's just a lot of hard work. It's totally. There's very little magic involved. But and the thing for me, again, is that at the time, I don't think I really appreciated the art history classes I was taking.
I never got them, but I definitely appreciate art history now, more now than I would have, back when I was in school.
I mean, I think the reason why it's important isn't just because it's interesting or because you should have respect for these people who blaze a trail for you, but because it contextualizes the work that
you
make.
Gives you context. So huge. Yeah. For anything that you want to pursue, you got to know, I guess, where it came from, right?
Yeah. I mean, the thing, too, is if you're making something today and you're like, wow, this is so cool, look at this thing I made. It's like, well, you know, someone in the 60s did that, and they did it better, so you don't need to do it anymore.
Exactly.
You can go do something else now.
Yeah. Do you think so about... is that how you think about art when you're about to tackle a project?
I think that it sort of depends on the project. So there is a firm separation between work and art, and I think that's mandatory. I think when someone starts paying you for something and you start thinking about what they want rather than what you want, you begin answering questions for them. So a thing that I often think about when it comes to, for instance, a lot of work I do is involved in the advertising world.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's very commercial. I do a lot of work for banks, for ATB, Coast Capital. I do a lot of work for Facebook, for instance.
Nice.
When you are building something commercial, especially if you consider advertising not just the illustration element of it or the picture making, but the whole, in a holistic sense, you're trying to answer questions for people, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is what you want. This is what you need. Don't think about it anymore. Buy our product. Do this thing. You know, and it's not always, you know, negative. Sometimes you're advertising for charitable organizations. So the issue is like, we want the world to be a better place, and this is how we can do it, right? So, you know, it's like a very clear direction of conversation, right?
Yeah.
Whereas I think that one of the things that fascinates me about fine art or conceptual art or even just like a personal illustration practice, whatever it happens to be, is it's really not about answering questions. It's more about asking them, you know? You create something, you put in the world, and people can have a conversation about it. Does that make sense to you?
So the piece itself asks questions.
Yeah, and I think it's not necessarily so overt as well, right? Like, if someone puts, like, you know, a mural on a wall, right, people are going to interact in all sorts of different ways, and there's no clear defined boundary for how it should be or how people have to use it or, like, you know, in branding, right, there's this idea of, like, brand activation, all these other awful buzzwords that are really about, like, how do we measure whether or not we inject an idea into somebody's brain?
Yeah.
Whereas if you're making a fine art piece for yourself or whatever it happens to be, like, maybe that's your goal, and that's totally valid and totally fine, but usually it's more like, I made this thing, what do you think of it?
It's such a free-for-all. The reason I asked that question is, especially when you're trying to pursue technical skills and you're making work, if you think of the context of your art as you're making it, that you don't want to repeat something that's been done, you know, it's very hard to even paint a portrait without thinking like,
right.
Oh, crap.
It's impossible, right?
Yeah.
I mean, anytime you have an idea, someone's probably done it.
Totally, yeah. So you're just hoping to do it better, basically, at that point.
Yeah, again, it's not about where you take it from, but it's where you take it to, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I want to talk about the client work in a bit. It sounds like, after looking at your website, it sounds like you've built up quite a clientele by this point, which is really impressive. But just to finish up with the school stuff, so actually, as you're talking about it, like an idea of what an artist is, when you did go into your school, what did you think your life would be like as an artist? Like, how did you imagine it?
Oh man, that is a complicated question.
Let's hear it.
I think it was very foggy for me. My immediate concerns were, I need to get a degree so that I can move out and get on with my life. But I think I had this idea that, you know, you kind of all just sit around, and like I said, like, lightning strikes you, like that scene in Back to the Future, and you're just like, oh my God, your whole life flashes before your eyes, and you have this amazing idea, and it comes out of nowhere, and I don't know why that's such a powerful sort of image, right? Like that idea of like divine inspiration.
It's
is
so romanticized, yeah.
Yeah, it's a very absurd, romantic idea of how everything gets made, and I think it's reinforced by culture, you know, in a way of making it a... It's like mystifying when somebody makes an art piece, right? It's like, how could someone have done that? How could someone have painted a hand that beautiful? It's like, well, you know, he just looked at a lot of hands. And
it's good when you, well, for better or for worse, if you're selling artwork, it's probably a good thing to have.
There's a mystique to it as right? It's like, oh, this could only have been made by this one person this one time, and there's a story to that.
This person is a wizard.
Yeah, he just, like, he had a divine incantation, and he waved his hands, and that thing appeared. But, I mean, I think anyone who's ever had to do anything difficult in their lives knows that it's not that way. Like, a building doesn't magically appear. Someone had to, like, lay every brick.
Yeah, yeah.
And all of a sudden you have a cathedral. You just have to work at it.
Yeah. White art, I guess, yeah. Art is just, maybe not as many people do. That's why it's so mystified. Like, I mean, because plenty of people make buildings. And like you said, they're really impressive as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I think that it's, I think people buy into it for a number of reasons. I don't think that I have a particular insight into it. But I do think that it's something that is, again, very romantic, right? Mm-hmm. Like, it's this idea that art is beyond us. You know, you look at this picture that someone makes and it speaks to you, and it, like, a human being could not have done this. This is like this came from somewhere else. That's why it speaks to me so much. That's why it leaves this impression on me or makes me feel this way. But it's like, I mean, we don't always know where pictures come from when we're making them. That's true, because it's complicated, but, like, you still did it.
Man, I hope someone says that about my work one day. That's a pretty nice compliment.
Yeah, well, you never know.
You're not human.
You just have to tell them a story, you know?
Okay. You'll have to help me out with that. Mm. We'll come up with some stories from my art.
We can work on it, yeah.
Okay, gotcha. We'll make an artist statement together. It's going to be very cool. Actually, also, let's see. So you graduated, you survived the super grueling hours, which... Actually, before I continue, for those hours, would you have preferred it any other way? Or did you like how it turned out, the school?
I'm happy with it. I think that there are meaningful gripes to be made about the school, in terms of the fact that, like, we didn't get to use computers for 2 years. That's weird.
Yeah, that's odd.
In terms of the way the program is structured and what we were taught, and so on. I mean, I think those gripes are perfectly fair. But at the end of the day, I felt like I got what I needed out of it, which again was not technical training so much as it was community. Mm-hmm. You know, if I want to learn how to make an animation, like, yeah, okay, I need someone to help me with that. I don't have, like, when you're young and you're starting out, you need someone to teach you the basics.
Yeah,
for sure. That really helps a lot, right? But you don't need that necessarily if you just want to, like, make a picture. What you need is someone to encourage you to do it.
Exactly. And then what percentage would you say the school, but like the school as a facility itself, played in your success versus everything else from kind of effort, community, but like as a facility itself with its teachers, for example? You know what I mean?
Right, yeah. In terms of faculty and facility, I think that I don't think I can meaningfully put it into a percentage.
Okay.
But I can say, for instance, that I really needed that structure.
Okay.
And not everyone would agree with that. I think there are people who went to that school who are good going in and good going out, and they probably could have spent 4 years just, like, mowing lawns, and they would have learned probably the same amount.
Wow.
But I think for me, going into it knowing nothing, I think having some kind of baseline was very, very helpful.
I only ask because sometimes it feels some artists that you meet that are, whether, like, so hardworking or so talented, all they needed was to just put those hours in, and sometimes, like, a school is just a... like a vessel to let them be and let them create. You know what I mean? Like, it almost feels like sometimes, despite your teachers, whether they're going to be good or bad, the fact that, like, you're put into that situation, some people are able to make themselves better and teach themselves. So sometimes it feels like a school is just a supportive tool, while you probably could have seen that artist get better on their own as long as, you know, they had the right, like, books or something, like the right direction, exposure. And you were mentioning role models before too, you know, like, as long as you're exposed to that, some people are able to just... that will be enough for some people to go ahead with it.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think that one of the things that was quite helpful in school is simply exposure. You're exposed to different ideas, mm-hmm. different ways of thinking, different ways of working. And I think that for me, especially because I didn't have any kind of arts background, I had a very, very narrow view of what I could make, what other mm-hmm. people were making, what kind of film was out there, what kind of poetry was out there, what kind of books I could read. But when you meet people who are... from a different background or have a different practice. For instance, I'm not really a painter, but you meet someone who's like, you know, a painter. You're like, wow, this is like a real thing. You're a real, you're a real living, breathing person. Yeah. And if you can do it, then surely why can't I do that someday, right? Like, you have permission to sort of pursue these weird courses of action, right?
It's odd that that's what it, it that is what it takes. And so I was curious, it struck me that that's what you mentioned when you're living in Calgary, that because you didn't know that making a living as an artist was even possible because you never saw it around you. It just makes you think about the value of exposure to these kind of like possibilities in life.
I think that's the thing. I mean, if I was, there's one piece of advice I could give younger students is that you just need to look as much as humanly possible and recognize that, like, it is, people make all sorts of crazy art out there, and they and some of them even make a living doing it, right? And it's not unreasonable to eventually get to that point, right?
I'm trying to think where that came from for me. I don't remember a time when you kind of know that people who work in animation make a living just by the fact that they can go to work and go home. It's like, oh, I guess that's a job. So I'm trying to think how I found out, because I don't think it was a one person kind of, you know, it wasn't one person that I heard about. It was like, oh yeah, that's, you know, that means it's possible. It was just like those facilities existed somewhere, and I kind of went along that down that path.
Yeah, and I realize that speaking about it is a little absurd when you put it this way, but for instance, you know, I grew up watching a ton of animation, you know. I was like a child of Tex Avery and Chuck Jones, and, you know, I spent my entire life watching these cartoons, and, you know, I guess I just thought they just came out of a black box somewhere, like someone uncovered it from like a Mayan temple, and like, oh, well, here's the site. No, like people, clearly someone had to make these drawings, and someone made a living doing it.
It's like so many things in life, though. You just, until you question it or find out, it's such a mystery, or we just don't even think about it. Like, for example, you know, you could be a sommelier for a restaurant, and all you could do, go places, taste wine, and be like, okay, we're gonna buy like 100 cases of these. That's a job.
Yeah, you're not someone who's involved in the restaurant industry or has given it some thought to it or whatever happens to be, like, yeah, I guess you just never.
As an example, you know, it's like, or for people who are maybe into comedy, like, hey, did you know that you could be a person who would be called a plusser or something? Like, you go into, you read a script and you try to plus it up by putting more jokes into it. That's also a job. And like all these, how would you know? You know, how would you know?
And again, that's just exposure, right? It's just like meeting lots of people from different backgrounds and being open to the stories that they have to tell you.
Totally. Yeah. For me, for example, actually, when I was working in animation already, and I was kind of playing with the idea of doing design or concept art, and it just like seemed fun, but almost felt like unreachable. And then I met a guy who's a good friend of mine, Patrick Clancy, and he was studying at Capilano to be like a designer or concept artist. So I was like, wait, people go to study that, huh?
That's like a real, it's a job, like someone had to do that?
He's like, but it was almost like, yeah, oh, he's just like studying and then he's gonna go and work at that job. So it is, I guess it's kind of funny how things only click a certain way when they do click. Otherwise, everything is around, you just don't know it.
Right, and as a 33-year-old, that sounds so ridiculous, but, you know, as a much younger person, like my late teens or early 20s, it was like something I needed. I needed someone to be like, oh yeah, no, I did a thing for the New York Times. I made this thing, and like, oh, a human that I can meet and shake their hand, like, I could, you know, I can do that now. I have permission to sort of pursue that in some way.
And that's what you're saying about how kids are told that they can just like reach for a star or whatever and have it and be that person. It's better so, because not only you don't know so much, it's better to realize it a little later, maybe, because you're not going to be able to aware of all the steps that you need to take to a certain, you know, to get to a dream. You know what I mean? Like, it would be cool if younger people, or even ourselves included, when like someone gave us good advice, could follow it when we were younger, but, you know, most likely that just wouldn't happen.
Nah, I mean, if you gave me this advice when I was young, I probably wouldn't listen to it anyway.
Exactly.
That's just the folly of youth, and you can't get away from
that. We always go back to this, when I ask a question about, yeah, kind of giving yourself advice when you're younger, it's like, yeah, probably wouldn't listen anyways, but here it is.
Here it is for any lonely souls out there.
Yeah, if you're listening and you're going to get this advice, yeah, just listen. It's going to be so much better down the road.
Yeah. Yeah. But life is not about solving problems all the time. It's a process and experience, and you kind of have to just go through it sometimes, right?
There's some very good advice right there.
Oh, man.
So deep. All right, so you graduated, you started doing some freelance, became very busy, and all of a sudden, was there a point where you're taking too much work? I want to talk about work-life balance specifically. Because as a freelancer, you have to teach yourself that, right?
I think that there are definitely times when I've taken on too much work. And you know that because, you know, you're up till, you know, 6 in the morning and you get like 3 hours of sleep and you're answering emails because everything's still on fire and you have to fix things and so on. But I think that generally speaking, I'm pretty happy with the work-life balance that I've found for myself. The corporate work that I do is very corporate. I'm very grateful for it. I'm happy to do it. And it's very much problem solving. You know, we have this campaign. We need this kind of image. This is like what we pitched a client. Can you do this for us? And I can just give them a very straightforward yes, no answer. You know, it's kind of a nice break from having to solve your own problems all the time. And it's like, I know how long it's going to take because I've done it a million times. I know what the pitfalls are. I know who I'm working with. You know, here's how a client will probably react because this is like a long-standing relationship. They don't like this, etc. You know, it's very normal in a design studio to have those kinds of questions answered. And I think that, generally speaking, corporate work pays quite well. You know, it's like not particularly sexy work, but it doesn't matter. I mean, I'm perfectly happy to do it.
Gotta make a living.
Yeah, and I don't think there should be any disdain or shame or, you know, oftentimes artists have this idea that everything they make has to be like the most fruitful use of their time. It has to be like they have to have their voice in it, and if not, then, you know, there's that idea of the artist ego, which I don't particularly agree with, but, you know, you hear it sometimes, right? Like someone being upset because you gave something to a company and they changed it, right? It's not yours. You know,
you're getting paid for it after all, and then you're just a tool. I mean, actually, yeah, you're just hired to do the job.
And I think that's perfectly fine. I mean, if I was a woodworker and someone came up to me and asked me to make a cabinet, and I gave them a cabinet that they didn't ask for because I thought it was better, like, they're going to be like, this doesn't fit in my house. What are you doing? You know?
But do you think you have that healthy relationship with it because you do, during your free time, end up making work for your soul and kind of yourself?
Yeah, I think 100%. Yeah. That's truthful. I think that the balance is extreme in that I don't try to do everything I want all the time, but I try to carve out time for myself. You know, if I can make a bunch of money on, you know, X, Y, or Z job for this large company or whatever it happens to be, that means that I can spend the rest of my month working on projects that are really personal to me, right? And the pressure of them having to be successful in a monetary sense isn't there anymore.
Yeah.
You know?
That's definitely a bonus. But does the lack of time make your personal art better? Because a lot of the time does go to, you know, the corporate job.
I don't know if that's necessarily true, but I do think that what often happens is that something I really think is important is having a whole bunch of work going that's in different phases. So, for instance, if you're going to be making a whole bunch of pictures, you shouldn't do all your concepting at once and then do all the development and then do all the finish at the same time because you just get bored. You need to context switch between tasks, right?
Yeah.
So if I'm working on a very, like a large commercial project, for instance, where I'm like just like finishing up and I have to like fix all the edges and go in and take 10 hours, you know, fixing the Illustrator file or whatever, I can take a break from that now and again and just like sketch my sketchbook and draw goofy stuff and come up with ideas or whatever. Because you're not exercising the part of your brain when you're finishing up the last bits of a painting anyway, right?
Yeah.
So I feel like that balance of like keeping it churning and keeping it going is really important. Would you agree with that?
Yeah. No, that's. I'm just the reason I like kind of nodding and thinking. I'm trying to think of all the artists I know and how they prefer to work, because I have a feeling we're going to run into some artists who like routine. This is the only way to do that. But I like your advice that the variety to me in art is very important, even like just within the looks, but even the stage you're talking about. Yeah, I agree with that. And especially if you're pursuing like a really large body of work, it's so easy to get, like, I mean, you'll not easy, but you'll get bored within that long process. You know, if it takes you half a year to complete a body of work.
Right. Yeah. And yeah. I mean, that's not unheard of, obviously, but you will get bored if you have to draw, you know, 500 people in the same style. For one client, you're going to lose your mind if you don't exercise other parts of your brain working on other kinds of projects.
And I think that's just being an artist. You need to like get excited about certain things, or always be excited about art. If you're only painting portraits, you're gonna get pretty sick.
Which is, I mean, you know, if that's your thing, then so be it. That's cool. I totally respect that. You know, it might not be mine, but if you do it, then great. One thing that I think that speaks to that for me as well is that because I have a background in design, sort of agency life. I mean, again, I was only for, you know, 3 or 4 years, something like that, early career. But when you're given a project, you don't have like a house style, right? you have to solve the problem using whatever you have. And if it has to be photography, you go hire a photographer. If it has to be illustration, a certain kind of illustration, you know, you have to go learn how to do that, or you have to find someone who can do it, or whatever it happens to be. You're not really looking at your hands and saying, well, I only make this one kind of work, so I can't do this anymore. And that's something I try to keep in mind when I'm working on projects. I try to think about, I mean, obviously I have limitations in terms of my abilities and what I can do, and how much money I can spend on personal projects and so on, money and time. But I try to keep it pretty fresh. I try to do like different things just because I have an idea that suits a particular style that I might not know how to do. Or like, for instance, I did a bunch of animation recently. I don't know how to do that, but I had to, you know, do my best to teach myself and talk to my friends and pull on the resources that I do have, right?
What was it for?
I did a bunch of animation stuff for Facebook recently.
How do you get Facebook as a client?
I have no idea.
Good answer.
They contacted me, I think, about a year and a half, maybe 2 years ago, to do some photo frames, which are it was like, you know, here, a happy pet day, here, draw some animals, so
nice.
And I was put in touch with a number of people there, and they're a great client to work for. Whatever you may think of them as a company, I do know the people I work with are great people. They're really fun to talk to. They've been like super supportive. And I just talk on Messenger a lot with my friends because I'm at home all the time as a freelancer, and you have to be able to talk to people. So I just asked if I could talk to the person that makes all the stickers, and they put me in touch, and now I'm just doing that.
Man. That's you make it sound so simple. You just go get it kind of thing.
Well, I mean, awesome. They could have just as easily said no, which would be perfectly fine, but you have to ask. And if you don't ask, you can't be upset when you don't get it.
Totally. No, I love it. that's the approach. Did they let you work, or when you're working for them, did you get to work in a similar style, I guess, to what you would enjoy making during your as your personal work?
Yeah, actually, one of the things I like about working for them, for instance, you know, I'm doing like sticker packs, which are just like, they're just like fun illustrations.
Oh yeah,
you know,
yeah.
I'm not gonna try to change the world making a like, making a bunch of like instant messenger stickers. But they've been very supportive and just like, hey, you know, whatever you think is gonna be good, just like pitch some ideas to us, and we'll go back and forth, and we'll have a conversation on the phone about it. And you know, you send a couple of style samples, and they're just like, yeah, okay, that's cool. they've been really, really good, and I think because they're this giant sprawling corporation that has, you know, thousands of people working for them, they can afford to do that in a way that like smaller companies can't.
Yeah, I guess they can. But this is not even taking a risk though. It's just like them being able to go in multiple directions, right?
Right. Yeah. They, you know, they have so much work coming out for them all the time that it's not so precious for them anymore, and I think that's really valuable.
Mm-hmm. And you touched on style, and that's actually the thing that's, it is quite noticeable when looking through your portfolio, is that you have a lot of varied work, and if you've done just like different pieces that are like varied looks. Is there a specific look you kind of tend to go with when you work on your own stuff?
Yeah, I think that generally speaking, I try my best to be aware of my strengths and weaknesses. I'm not a particularly strong draftsman. You know, I'm not a great figurative painter or anything like that. I have no aspirations to be, so I don't feel too much shame saying that. But I think the thing that I am particularly interested in is shape design.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I think it comes across.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
You know, it comes from like a design background. You know, it's just about very simple contrast. So I think that's the thing that I try to keep in mind primarily when I'm working. I try to draw thumbnails very, very small, and I try to just like have big expressions in them. Like for instance, I'm trying my best now to do a little bit of 3D modeling. I'm contributing, as I was again mentioning previously, I contribute to a bunch of pop culture shows in the States, right? So that's Gallery 1988 in LA, and also Bottleneck Gallery in Brooklyn, and Hero Complex, which I think is in LA as well. And that I got put into that a number of years ago for a Hellboy show. I was so lucky to, you know, a guy pulled my name out of a hat basically, and he's like, hey, do you want to, you know, be part of the show? So I made a 5-foot screen print for it, like a really huge, ridiculous thing. I think my goal was just to have the biggest piece possible so that in all the photos you'd see it.
You just wanted all the attention.
Yeah, so there's a photo of Mike Mignola ignoring it, which I'm very happy about.
Very nice, yeah.
But because of that, it was in 1988, I believe. They just like put me on a mailing list, and I've been lucky enough to contribute to shows for the past couple of years.
Wow. See, why do you make it seem all so simple? It's just, oh, it just.
I mean, I think the.
And I'm sure it is. It just like sometimes from the outside, it feels like getting into certain galleries. Just it's, yeah, it is a mystery. And then it's like, oh, you just talk to this guy.
It's a mystery to me too. I don't know. Right. But to my point, I was saying that I'm trying to do a bit of 3D modeling, and I'm like, I made this a sculpture for the show that's coming up, which I don't think I'm allowed to reveal what the theme of the show is yet.
Okay. Are you 3D printing it?
Yeah, I have no idea what I'm doing. I was looking to getting a cast in bronze, and it's like $500, so maybe not. But hey, you know,
depends how much you sell it for, though.
Well, I don't think it's gonna sell for that much, but I'm just gonna do my best to make something. You know, like why not? Yeah. If it fails, it fails, and I'll do my best. And the reason I love these group shows is because it's not all riding on my shoulders. You know,
a lot of pressure.
Well, there's pressure because I want to make something good, and I want to be part of this community. I want to be invited back. You know, I want to impress my peers. But you can experiment and do weird stuff, and yeah, that's sort of the great venue for it, right?
And that's a fun part of it is that it is a one-off, and just go crazy. You don't have to, just by creating one piece, it seems like there's a lot more freedom to experiment and.
Yeah, and I mean, I've certainly made work that I consider, you know, largely to have failed for shows, but I did my best and I tried something new, and if it didn't work, it didn't work, and that's cool. No biggie.
I had this question written down. How did you end up getting into 3D? Because I saw you build some mechs at a certain point.
Man, I have no idea what I'm doing. When I before I went to art school, and again, my school is it was a really old school. Like everything was cut paper, and you're building stuff of like you're building 3D animals out of paper and stuff, and they're
high tech.
Very high. They're dumping out these oil pastels, and you're like, well, we're all gonna make, you know. I was actually doing a bunch of 3D work because I'm just a big nerd, and I was an engineering student, and it seemed to be appropriate.
There you go. Yeah, and you said you like math, which surprised me.
Yeah, well, maybe not so much anymore, but I was like something I was really into when I was younger. I was doing a bunch of 3D work just because I thought it was like a really interesting medium. You know, I went to school and they kind of beat it out of me in a sense because they're like, we don't do that here. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm kind of trying to go back to that a little bit now and again. I just find it enjoyable because, again, it's just shape design. You know, you're just making stuff. You see what happens. It's very different than having to solve conceptual problems, right? You know, it's very much just like you're struggling with the tools. You're trying to get this idea out, but you're not spending all this time trying to ponder, you know, the meaning of the work that you're making. You know, you make a cool robot, that's fine. It's okay. It doesn't have to, like, change the world. You just made, like, a cool robot.
Yeah, fair enough. That's how it is. So now that you're making a piece right now, you're back into the 3D software?
Yeah, I'm really enjoying it. I'm using something called Fusion 360, which is a parametric modeling software. And I know that some film studios use it to build props.
Because it's so accurate, right? Like the measurements for
it's all built in physical space, and it's not polygonal. It's not quite NURBS, but it's very very similar. My understanding is that the math behind it is actually really complicated. But you know, you draw a box, and the box is just defined as a box, and everything is a Boolean, for instance. So
But you just taught yourself all that stuff.
Man, YouTube's great.
YouTube is very good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good to pick up a lot. That's so interesting that you're, I mean, outside of the design and drawing illustration, just throwing 3D in there, just why not?
Well, I mean, I don't have any plans to take over the world with this. I just want to try it out and see what happens. But I'm really enjoying it because it's a very different way of thinking. It's very methodical. It's very slow. You can't rush your way through it.
Yeah. Do you have other plans that are to take over the world?
I don't know if I can reveal that on a radio. No, I mean, for me, I think the thing that I'm sort of settling into now is understanding that I don't really care about, you know, being like a world famous artist of any kind, because as soon as you do, you have all this pressure on yourself to succeed. And like, you know, being real, like most of us are not going to be the next Rembrandt or Velasquez or Goya, right? We're going to make things we like and we care about. Yeah, but you can't be upset about that.
Joking.
That's ridiculous.
I'm
right? But it's like we're just doing the best we can to make the things we want, right?
So what does success look like to you then?
I think success to me is ideally being able to wake up each day excited to work on something, you know? Whether that's corporate stuff or personal stuff or 3D or 2D, or it doesn't even have to, honestly, it doesn't even have to be for art. If you're just excited to wake up next to someone you care about, you know, that's cool too, right?
It's a good life. Well, so, but then actually, if you didn't have to worry about the financial side, would you make as much art as you do now?
Yeah. Oh, yeah? Man. I have to do it. It's like a compulsion.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, if I won the lottery, I'd probably just open a gallery and keep working.
Nice. I love that idea. Put a little art space in the back.
That'd be nice, right? Yeah,
maybe a coffee shop above it.
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe run an arcade. I don't know. I'll have to figure that out.
Okay. I really hope you win the lottery. I want to see this happen.
We'll see. I think the thing is, yeah, I would be making pictures regardless. This is a terrible career to pursue if you're just trying to make money.
Yeah. But at this point, do you feel stable, though, like with freelance especially?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's always a little nerve-wracking when you don't have a client email in like a week because you're not sure if you're freelancing or you're unemployed.
Just always riding that fine line.
It's true, and I think that never really goes away. I mean, I talk to freelancers who are in their 50s and are quite successful, and they're just like, yeah, I don't know if I have a career anymore, you know, because I haven't heard from my publisher in a week. And it's like, yeah, I guess.
And so, actually, and this is what I wanted to ask is that, would you try to build up something that would be self-driven, that you kind of are you trying to get to a point where you just make your own work will be a sustainable way of living, like and this is specifically I guess talking about the Bummer Club.
I think that's kind of a complicated question to answer, because right now, for instance, I'm running this like weird side gig called Bummer Club, which is selling pins and whatever weird ephemera that I'm making.
I love wage slave.
Yeah, thank you. And it's just kind of a creative outlet. But I think the moment you have to rely on that in order to make
a living. Oh, is it going to ruin it?
Yeah. Well, do you know what I mean when I say that, right? Because right now I'm just making goofy stuff, and if nobody buys it, then I have 100 pins I just give away to my friends. I don't care. It doesn't matter. It's money that I assume that I've flushed down the toilet, and if someone buys it, that's great. I'm like very proud of that, you know, if someone enjoys it. But I think that the moment you rely on that to keep a roof above your head, it changes the dynamic a little bit.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think then of an idea of a, you do a lot of gallery shows then, would you want to be just a gallery artist?
I think that would be pretty fun, but I think that's not realistic right now. The gallery shows are really wonderful, but like I'm not getting paid very much for those. Those are like, you know, I make a print, maybe someone buys it, you make like a couple $100 or whatever, but
it's still a labor of love, basically.
Yeah, and I have no problem with that. I feel that balance for me is perfectly acceptable. I'm very happy and like proud to be part of those shows.
I'm still kind of, I think the whole idea of trying to figure out what a perfect lifestyle is, you know, probably going to be trying to balance it out for the rest of my life. But these kind of questions to me are always very interesting. That's why I'm asking. But I'm very very curious about people, about how they want to structure their life and how they want to create art. And I do relate to your idea or your thoughts on, you just want to make something you love, and you know whether it ends up making you money or not, doesn't matter. Luckily, because you have a job and supports you.
Yeah, I mean, I feel fortunate in that I have a career where I can use the skill set that I have to make a living. Whereas I think quite a few people that I do know who are phenomenal artists in their own right, they have to utilize something else. They have to work a job that maybe they don't like or is utilizing their skills in a way that isn't ideal, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas I feel super lucky that, you know, I can use the same part of my brain making goofy stuff or, you know, Bummer Club or whatever to work on a corporate project that's paying my bills and keeping a roof above my head.
100%. I think, if your skills are still getting better during the day while you're working on this other stuff that, you know, may not be the same vein, but you're still practicing the same tools or similar tools.
Yeah, I feel like it's like a benefit and a burden, in that the benefit's obviously that you get to hone your edge and sharpen your skills and so on. But I think the burden is that it becomes fuzzy sometimes and you begin to conflate. You're not sure what you're doing anymore. Like, are you exhausted from working on this one kind of thing for your client so you can't do it for yourself? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
There's
no clear separation of powers in that way.
And how often does that happen?
Sometimes. I mean, that depends on the situation. Yeah. You'd have to ask. I give you a different answer every day, probably.
Okay, I'll ask you a couple of times. Right now, who can you name an artist who you think is doing it right?
Is doing it right?
As far as lifestyle, work balance kind of goes,
they would have to be people that I don't know very well, probably.
Okay. So there's nobody
by definition.
Okay, sure.
But I think that, again, it's like this weird mystical thing. Like, for instance, one of the big reasons I went to art school, again, you know, I was looking at Designers Republic, and there's an artist who's still active now. He's quite good. His name is Joshua Davis, and he's a generative artist from New York. So he's writing scripts and making all sorts of crazy stuff. He's working in action script before, and now he works in processing mostly. So it's a really interesting generative art that's like reactive to visual and auditory input, which is very difficult to describe on a podcast.
So he has to make installations, basically, right?
It's installations. He works with a lot of different musicians around the world.
That's what it sounds like. It's probably perfect for shows.
Yeah, it's so, right? Man, that dude is really good. And I was very lucky that he came to Calgary for CAMP, which is a design conference that happens every year. And I got to meet him. He's just like a regular dude. He's from Brooklyn. He just like got a ponytail. He's an old dude. And I feel like he's kind of figured it out, you know, because it seems, at least his work-life balance is that he just makes something crazy and he puts it out there and someone bites and gives him a big, you know, truckload of money.
There's already going to be someone to bites it. And then I guess if his target audience is like big concerts, there's money there too.
And again, like, this is all, I'm sure he can like draw back the curtain and we'll see lots of problems. I have no idea. Yeah. I don't know him, but it's something I definitely admire, you know, like, you just like sit there and you pursue something you think is interesting, and then someone is like, hey, I could use that.
Yeah.
Can I use that?
That sounds really cool. Yeah. But I guess, like you said, nothing is ideal. And he's probably looking at your work and be like, man, this combo guy.
I wonder.
He's got it figured out.
I mean, well, I think for me, one of the things I really enjoy doing is having art shows of my own. Mm-hmm. You know, I've curated shows in the past. I ran a show in Calgary called Bun and Games, a hot dog restaurant. It was video game themed, which is really fun. You know,
I love it. Yeah, it's a great concept.
I'm doing a show in Vancouver June 15th at the James Black Gallery.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So the show is called Bastard Tongue, and it's just like I'm taking all these old master paintings from like the Western art canon and just like ruining them, basically.
No.
Well, I mean, it's a matter of
doing a new take,
doing some kind of take. Yeah. But you know, beyond like raw promotion for that thing, I think the thing that interests me is just having a space, making a bunch of work, and just seeing how people react to it.
I love it.
You know.
But okay, before we go into the theme and the whole idea, why art shows or why gallery shows specifically?
I think
because I asked that myself. But
right, I think the reason why is because it's a unique contextualization of the work.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, you know, if you see a piece of work in a public sphere, you know, just like pasted up on the side of a building versus in a gallery, which is meant to be a contemplative space, versus an advertising thing which you're trying to ignore because your ad blocker doesn't work or whatever it happens to be, like, these are all the context of the space changes the way you interact with the work, right? If it's like in the public, maybe it just becomes background eventually. If it's an ad, it becomes obnoxious. If it's just like a thing your friend made and gave you, it has a sentimental value to it, right? But a gallery space, I think it tries to be like this neutral, contemplative area.
But also a place to actually look at art.
Right. It's a place you go to look at art. It's not something that's incidental to the space. It's like the necessary component to it. Maybe that's an ego thing. I don't know.
No, that's a very good answer. But also, well, as an artist, I'm sure there's a tiny bit of ego in everyone. But doesn't have to be for bad reasons. Like what we talked about before, is that like you often make work for people to see, maybe ask questions, and to enjoy. Like you need to have the end result is someone witnessing the work that's been done.
Right. Yeah. Sometimes the work you make is just for you, right? I mean, we've all made things that are just like, I really like this, but no one else is gonna like this, so no one else can see it.
Yeah. Or yeah. No. There's definitely that. There's sketchbooks full of.
And that's everybody has that. Yeah. You know, that's perfectly normal. You know, you don't need to show everybody everything you made. But at the same time, like, you know, we're trying to put something out there in the world, right?
Yeah.
To get a reaction, to communicate with people, to share an idea. Maybe it's an idea that, maybe, for instance, it's like a philosophical or political or religious idea. Whatever it happens to be, you have something to say to the world and you want people to listen to you.
So what's your idea for this Bastard Tongue? I love the name, by the way. It's like a good band name.
Yeah, it's a great metal name.
Yeah.
The idea is that I'm taking all this work. So, for instance, there's reproductions of, you know, a Da Vinci or like a Monet or a Goya.
Goya is the best one so far I've seen.
Yeah, thank you. You know, there's like a Caravaggio. You know, it's like the big names in like Western art, which is a very narrow spectrum of obviously like the full history of art. But it's like the things you're sort of taught about in art history, and they permeate pop culture.
And things most people have seen, yeah.
Right, exactly. Yeah. I think that's very important. You know, for instance, I did a for Goya, I did a Saturn devouring his child, which is a very, it's like a painting I think a lot of people have seen.
It's still striking.
It's a very striking, super crazy painting.
Yeah.
But the idea is that I'm stripping away all the emotional content of each image and bleeding them dry, essentially. Which I understand sounds super arrogant, but that's cool. They're dead already. They're not going to see me.
That's right. But how come? So why did it start with these paintings specifically? It is because of their context that they have that you can play with?
I think because they're recognizable, we can do things to them, and people will not say, you know, that's a paint. That's like a picture of a woman. They'll be like, oh, that's a Monet painting that has a particular kind of idea and charm to it. All those paintings, right? When you go to the Met and you go sit around and look at water lilies, right, all you can think of is the person, the mystique around them, this image. It conjures up a particular time and place and era, you know, a certain notion, a certain idea. You look at a Goya painting and you can't help but think about the Spanish Civil War, for instance, and how it affected him, you know, if you're interested in that kind of history. But what happens if you sort of strip it all away until there's nothing left but just like the raw image, like the plan for the image in a way? So I did that to a whole bunch of them, and I'm putting them all together in a gallery space. And I think the thing is, the reason it's called bastard tongue is because a bastard tongue is like a sloppy language, right? I'm trying to get all these pieces to talk to each other using the same visual language, even though they come from different eras and they come from different people, and all the emotional content, again, has sort of been like drained out of them.
Really cool. Well, that's also a really good way to learn art history while making work.
I mean, it's also very navel-gazy. It's like something I'm very interested in. It's like a style of image making that I really enjoy. It's like visual problem solving, you know?
Yeah. Love it. And I guess in this case, it's like you trying to make it also clear and still read like that piece, but just enough.
Right. Yeah. How much can you take away before it's unrecognizable?
Exactly.
You know what I mean? That's like a...
I like that game. That's a fun one to play.
That is exactly what it is. Yeah. It's a game, and it's really enjoyable from, you know, the execution side of things, right?
And so, but you're creating the work for these are digital pieces though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And how do you plan to, what size, how big are we thinking?
I originally wanted to do them like the proper sizes of all these pieces, but the paintings are too big. It's impossible. No, I mean like they're like...
It'd be really cool.
There's like a sergeant painting there that's like 25 feet tall in real life.
Which one? What is the...
Madame X.
Oh, there you go. Yeah. I got it. As we're speaking, I'm just browsing through his Instagram. By the way, go to... Combo_inc, so KOMBOH_INC on Instagram. Go check it out while we're chatting about this stuff. It's looking really cool. Yeah, sorry, you're saying about this one.
So eventually, yeah. I mean...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. There's a Wyeth.
Yeah. There. Yeah.
So eventually, I just had to print them using whatever means I had available. I have a large format, like archival inkjet, so I just did them 17x22.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so if I need something printed, I'm going to you, right?
Yeah. Call me up, man.
But you're still adding a little bit of handmade quality to those paintings, like the texture and the bit of like inky feeling that you got.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just playing around with it, same as anybody else. I'm just going to see what happens. So I made about 30, and I culled it down to 23. I'm eventually going to hopefully have about 50. I'm going to try to make some kind of weird art history textbook where I just like take the Wikipedia entry and I just like, and I just like cross out most of the words until there's nothing left. I mean, for me, I think humor is a big part of the work that I make.
It is, and that's actually what I was going to say, is that even like whether it's Bummer Club or this like other stuff, like there's definitely humor in there, and it can be dark, but it's very much present, and I like it. Like the way you're playing with these ideas, it is playful.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's one thing that I hope comes across is not cynicism. It's a sense of sincerity and respect for the things I'm making. But yeah, I mean, we get to draw cartoons for a living, like. How can you not make that playful or try to make that fun, you know?
Sounds like good times.
Yeah, I'm happy to be doing it.
Okay, sorry, I'm actually a little distracted just looking at all the pieces. I very, very much looking forward to that show. And it'll be interesting to see this in size, because the way, you know, looking on screen is one thing, but then being able to witness these printed out large is going to be really cool.
And again, that's contextual, right? Yeah. Like, you can look at a painting I mean, you can go look at that Sargent painting on your computer screen, but then you like walk into the gallery and see it towering above you, and it becomes a very different kind of thing, right?
Yeah. And this is, and I don't know, like, the answer that I can give to myself for why I'm still trying to do gallery work, but I like the idea of being able to put, you know, a year of work or half a year of work or whatever it is into this one little thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it does feel little when you look at the amount of work that it took, you know, to get to that place, and it's gone so quick. And
I mean, it's celebratory in a way as well. Yeah. And like, it's an excuse to see people who you know and are interested in you, and just meet other people. And like, there's a lot of human friction in galleries, right? You get to meet people you wouldn't otherwise meet who are interested in things you're interested in. And that's a valuable thing to have in a public space.
Totally. One thing you mentioned when we kind of chatting on Instagram, one thing you brought up as a topic was that, speaking of kind of voice versus style, and what that means. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So in January, I was in New York because I was considering taking a master's at SVA.
Oh, really?
Which I certainly cannot afford at all.
It's New York. It's pricey.
Oh, it's a lot of money. Yeah. But I was very fortunate in that they gave me the time of day, and I got to meet Marshall Erisman, and we sort of walked around, sort of talked about it. And one of the things he was really harping on me for was that most people who come to a four-year program, they often have a style but not a voice.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what he means by that is that they have a particular look that they're striving for because they think it's interesting, or they think it's cool, or you know, any number of other reasons why you might enjoy painting like this one person.
Yeah.
You know, they see these people are successful, you know, Sachin Tang or James Jean or whoever, whatever, whatever contemporary artist is really hot. And they emulate it without really understanding it. And I think the point of the master's program, at least what he was trying to communicate to me, is that they're trying to solve a bigger problem, which is, what do you have to say, and then what is the best way to say it, right? Which is a very different kind of issue.
That's a very, very big one to tackle as well.
Right. Yeah. It's like a thing you spend the rest of your life working on. That's not something a master's program is going to teach you in 2 years. Like, you have to begin it early and just like work at it your whole life. And I think that it's a problem that is always going to be interesting as well, right? Like, I think that all my work looks kind of different. I mean, obviously there are similarities because I have only one, you know, one pair of hands and one skill set to work within. But I like to think that it has a particular voice to it, regardless of the medium that I'm working in.
Totally, it does.
I think that's important. I think it's also inescapable, right? Like, you can't get away from that, but it's important to think about it consciously and to be mindful of it.
But when you wrote that question, what made me think about voice specifically, and it's if that's what you want to do, I think I feel like having a voice fits a lot better when into the time when you get to make your own work rather than for someone else. It's very hard to have a voice when, as you said before, it's a piece that's being made for someone else.
Right. It's when you're working for somebody else, you're like, someone else is writing the lyrics and you're singing for them.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like, you're invaluable. You need to be there. They can't do without you, but it's not your song. Whereas if you're trying to make work for yourself, you're like left in a room, you know, with a blank sheet of paper, and you have to decide what matters to you. And it doesn't have to be serious. It doesn't have to be world changing.
Exactly.
You know, like, it can be just like a thing you find funny, or a joke, or, you know, this, like, you really care about this one person, so you just draw them a goofy thing to make them feel better. It doesn't matter. Like, there's no separation between that and like a big important painting, I don't think, really. Mm-hmm. Right.
Have you found your voice?
I don't know. You tell me.
Wouldn't you know?
Oh, I don't know about that. I like to think that I have a pretty clear idea of the things that interest me. And what I'm trying to say to the world.
At this point, you do know what you want to make and where to go?
I think generally speaking, I'm excited because there's so many things that I don't know about yet. Mm. You know, like, there's all sorts of ways of making pictures, or ways of expressing myself, or ideas in my head that I haven't had the time or the patience or the resolve to sort of pursue. But I think I have a pretty clear idea of who I am and what I'm aiming for, you know?
You seem strike me as super hardworking. And I think your portfolio shows as well. And even these 30, now toned down to 23 paintings, I think it's a pretty big statement to that, like the art show that you're making.
Yeah, I mean, I try to be diligent. I mean, I can always work harder. I always feel a sense of...
Everyone says that.
I feel a deep sense of shame when I'm up till 3 in the morning playing video games instead of working.
What are you playing?
Oh, I'm playing through Binding of Isaac again.
I do not know that.
Oh, man.
It's Binding of Isaac?
That's real good. It was made by Ed McMillan, who also made Meat Boy.
Oh, okay, okay.
It's great. It's great. I used to play our mutual friend, Douglas Nung. Mm-hmm. I used to play Street Fighter with him competitively for many years. You know, we like traveled around the world playing with people. Yeah.
Competitions.
We wasted our, we could, in the time we spent playing that game, we could have learned like 3 languages. You know, we could have like started a business
and
become famous.
That's you and like millions of kids. You know what's funny is that CBC, oh sorry, go ahead.
No, I just, a deep sense of shame has overcome me.
CBC recently did a series, or it was an interview with professional video game players, because that's the thing now. And they interviewed some people from, I think like from Ontario or something like that, who, yeah, as kids, they would just take a bus down to somewhere to the United States to play at those big competitions.
It's big business.
It's a big, it's a big thing. Well, now it is, yeah. Yeah, more so than back then.
Yeah, it's a weird thing that I'm like kind of happy is taking off, because I mean, you can imagine if you were 8 years old right now and someone told you like, yeah, you can make a living doing this, you can make a living clicking that mouse, I'd be like, yeah, I'm gonna do that.
You better love it.
Yeah, you better.
You're
love
gonna
it.
Turn that into a job. It's just like you're saying about painting.
Mm-hmm.
When you make your personal artwork a job, it may not be so fun anymore.
Right. I mean, even for some of those people, because I do know some people that do that professionally. Like, once you have to win instead of just trying to win, just to make a living and keep your sponsors happy, it's like not the same thing anymore.
All right, good to know. In case any of you are considering getting into professional gaming, or getting some good advice here. Actually, one thing I saw you've done is you've been to a number of art conventions, right, or festivals. How was that scene?
I think it's pretty fun. Like, I was very fortunate in that I got a very last-minute table at VanCaf in the last couple of weeks. They told me only 2 or 3 days in advance because it was a waitlist table. Mm-hmm. And I had a bunch of stuff prepared, so it was not a big deal.
That's nice.
It was wonderful. I think it's something that I would encourage basically anybody to get involved with at least a little bit. You know, try it out. See if it's for you. It's
okay.
Not, I think, because again, that sense of human friction, like you run to so many people that you would not meet otherwise, and you get to expose your work to them, and it's always very positive. Like, no one has ever said anything negative. I don't think it has anything to do with the quality of the work either. I think it's just that people are supportive of it. You know, you come across like a local artist or whatever, and you're like, wow, I can't believe people actually do this. You know,
it feels like joining like a family or something. Like, when you're surrounded by people there, you feel like you understand everyone, because everyone's kind of doing this, like everyone's trying to be like, make their cool art cool, and
everyone's just trying their best and like something they care about and see, put it out there in the world. And you know, maybe you walk through and most of it is not for you. I have no idea. But, like, you'll probably run into something that you think is interesting at the very least. And people are very receptive to having conversations about it.
Is it? But, you know, there's people who do these kind of events, as you could say it, like, as a full-time job, because they're, you know, they turned their creations, you know, into something that makes their living. How many of those, like, conventions have you done? The reason I ask is, like, do you think you'd be able to do them, you know, like, 20 a year?
Oh man, I don't know. I've done
flying and traveling.
I've done a fair number in my time. I think the issue for me is that the moment you rely on that again to make your
living, I know,
I
keep going back to that. I'm just, yeah.
But it's very important to be careful about, because you need to have that separation in your head, right? There is a sense of joviality when I'm there, because it's just very easy for me. You know, if I make, you know, I always make a reasonable living there. You know, I'm fortunate in that the work that I do has attracted some kind of audience, and it's a very like consumable style, and that's great. But also, if I relied on that, if I was like, if I don't make this much money to, you know, afford my rent or like buy me food, I'd be freaking out all the time. It'd be very different, I think.
Yeah. But it just makes me think about how it can become, I don't know why I keep going back to that. I think to me the curious thing is how people manage to, you know, make art while still survive. And maybe that's why I keep going back to this whole, like, you know, it's like art and then like balance it out with some sort of money coming in so you can, you know, live somehow and continue be able to do that. And this is why I guess I ask about just this different approaches to what art is. And of course, like, everything can burn you out at a certain point, and you just got to be careful with it. But it's just interesting to me to see how other people have, I guess, in some way figured it out, or whatever it is works for them.
I would never presume to say that the setup I have now is like perfectly ideal, either for myself or for other people. But I'm pretty happy with it for the most part, and I think that it's something that is like roughly banged into shape. You know, I hope as my career advances and I get older and I learn a little from my mistakes that the rough edges sort of get taken off. But generally speaking, I think this is a setup that I'm largely happy with. You know, like I have a job which is a job. You know, I have clients that come in and they want certain kinds of work that is not the same kind of work that I'd be doing for myself, that I'm happy to do. And then it allows me the freedom to sort of just like make whatever and just see, like, if someone buys it, that's cool. That's great. Whatever, yeah. You know, and not sweat so much and just not have that pressure for it to have to succeed for it to be successful, if that makes sense.
Yeah. So you're not moving to Hawaii anytime soon.
Oh man, I really like Hawaii though. Maui's pretty nice this time of year.
6 months there, 6 months here.
I think that something that I kind of would like to do is be able to spend time a little bit more on the road and work. A couple years ago, I was in Singapore for like a month and in Japan for a while, and I was like kind of working during that time, and it was really great. You know, my clients didn't care. Most of them didn't even know.
They didn't know exactly.
Yeah, it didn't really matter, you know? Like, if you're working freelance anyway, you can just stay up whatever hours you need. It's not a big deal.
Yeah.
You just have to be kind of awake during, you know, office hours in North America. And it's something that is very unique to being a freelancer, right? You often can't do that in other corporate jobs or jobs that require you to have, like, punch in a 9-to-5 or whatever it is.
And I don't know if I asked that yet, but I'll ask it. But out of a week, I know, because as you're saying before, there's not always a routine because of the amount of work that you get, but generally, would you say, like, during a week, do you know how much like the balance of like professional work versus personal work that you manage to do? Because
It does change quite a bit week to week, just because I work not on retainer for the most part, but largely for projects.
Yeah.
So for instance, you know, if three clients come in and I need to get something done that week and I have three deadlines in a row, then I'm obviously not going to work on my own stuff, because it's not fair to prioritize that if you agree to do something. But I think generally speaking, the split is like maybe 50-50 for the most part.
Oh, that's awesome.
Which is
that's a really good split.
It's a lot of personal work.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how common that is. You know, most people I know aren't freelancers. They're working regular studio gigs. So,
but no, that 50-50. That's nice.
Yeah, it's all right.
And are you okay those weeks when you don't get to do personal work?
Yeah, I mean, it's not like I can't do it later. You know, it's very rarely a time crunch for that kind of thing.
I usually stress myself out for no reason when I don't get to do personal work. There's an itch. Gotta make something.
Yeah, I mean, I feel that itch as well, but I think that itch can be scratched without having to make like a big finished thing.
Yeah, you know? No, it's true.
You go to a cafe, or I feel lucky enough to live near the seawall, so I just like hang out there with sketchbook and just draw goofy, dumb stuff.
Sneak something in. Sounds great. What's your happiest place, or a happy place?
Oh man, oh, that's so complicated. I didn't expect this question at all.
Is it?
I think that my happiest is it's that phase, you know, when you have an idea that's been in the back of your head for a long time and all of a sudden you can finally make it. Because for instance, you met someone who has the right equipment for you to make this thing. You know, you meet someone who can help you out with this kind of idea, and there's that like electricity in the air. It's like exciting because you haven't made any mistakes yet.
It's going so well.
You haven't screwed anything up yet. And you're like, I can like picture where this is going, and I think it's a really cool idea. Yeah. You know, I think that's it. And it's not, that can happen anywhere, you know.
It's definitely a good feeling when you see it about to happen.
Right. It's that sense of promise until you disappoint yourself later.
Until you fail a couple of times.
Right. Yeah. But I think there is that feeling that never really goes away. I think as I've gotten older or more experienced, like you always feel excitement. It's just like, oh, I can make this. This is real.
Yeah. And I feel like in those cases, usually I have to like, it's a weird feeling because you're about to see it happen and you like can't think of anything else, but you really got to make sure like once it starts going into production, whatever that is, it feels like, okay, don't maybe it'll work. Yeah, exactly. Don't screw it up.
Yeah. I mean, but I think, you know, that's like, you feel that way and then all of a sudden it's 6 a.m. and you're still hunched over your Cintiq or whatever with back problems, but like you just want to see what happens. It's like really, really, really exciting.
out of all your clients, which is a giant list, if you want to see, what's your website again?
Combo.com.
All right, there you go. What were the most favorite, least favorite?
Oh, wow.
It's that question.
Okay. I think my favorite client right now, I worked with a company called Beakerhead in Calgary, mm-hmm. and they're a non-charitable organization that puts on, like, I guess you'd call it like a science and art festival every year. Mm-hmm. It's kind of hard to describe. But they were really good to me in that they were really happy to be working with local creatives. And again, mm-hmm. like, there's a lot of talents in Calgary, a lot of very, very good people. But the well is not particularly deep just because of the numbers. Mm-hmm. It's just like, yep. there's not enough of an industry to support it. They let me kind of just do, you know, whatever. Like, wow. they let me have the whole side of a building one year where they invested a whole bunch of money in this, like, art project I got to make. I got to do the first legal graffiti in the city, and I got to meet the mayor, and it was all Damn. Weird. And I was like, why is this happening?
Legal
why?
Graffiti. That's such a weird naming, too.
I know. It's kind of an oxymoron, yeah, but... Yeah. They let me do it, you know, just like draw some goofy characters walking down the street, whatever you want.
How big was the wall?
It was pretty big. It was the side of two underpasses.
Okay, wow.
And they like installed it, and they just all push for it and everything. And it was like, I mean, the work itself isn't the thing about it that makes me smile. It's just like the supportive environment mm-hmm. and people like really pushing hard for it.
Nice.
You know?
A good feeling when people actually support art.
The worst client I had
oh,
is...
Yeah,
that's cool. Oh, man. I won't name and shame them, but they are a fast food giant that you've eaten at, that everyone's eaten at. I did... they had a campaign they asked me to help out with. This is done through an agency and not with them directly.
Mm-hmm.
Where they were bringing a sandwich back, like a famous fast food pork sandwich. I know this sounds really dumb already.
No, keep going.
But they're like... You know what? We want to have like a comeback tour for this thing. We're like, okay. What do you mean? Like, what if you did like a big gig poster for the sandwich? And I was like, okay, that sounds cool. And they're like, what if it was really metal? And I was like, yeah, all right. So I drew.
What else do you want? Yeah.
So I drew this big metal poster involving a big pork sandwich, and they're like, this is too metal. We can't. It's too metal. Too satanic. And we'll fix it. So they went in, and they like gave me like they revised the sketch or whatever. And I was like. And they're like, oh, we're really sorry, but like the deadline is like tomorrow. Can you help us out? And I was like, okay, you know, I'm working for you. You're paying the bills. I get it. I can do this. So I refine it and I send it over. And they're like, nah, we reworked it again. Can we do this and that?
Oh,
so
no.
Eventually, what happened is we went to this bizarre process where I actually didn't do anything. They eventually made everything. So I didn't need to be part of it at all.
They just wanted to see where they didn't want to go through you, basically.
It was very strange. And it was like, you know, they were in a different time zone. So I was working all night. And as soon as I fell asleep, they were looking at it throughout the day and they sent me feedback. So when I woke up, I could do it again. And it was like, man, that nightmare never ended. Also, my contact there quit her job without telling me. So I didn't get paid for like 6 months.
Wow.
I know. It was very messy.
That sounds pretty bad. And that's a big company, too, you're saying.
Oh, yeah. They're a very large company.
That's insane. That's really the mind-blowing part of it, is that you think that kind of lack of professionalism, whatever you want to call it, like, would be gone at that level, but
I mean,
not at all.
I think the thing is that everybody still wants to do the best they can. Like, mm-hmm. nobody anywhere wants to have bad work.
Hopefully.
Right? Well, I think it's true. Even working...
Just some people don't know, though. I think
right.
some people do not have the right... I don't know what it is. Or maybe they have... Maybe it's not even about the right eye or taste, but they have something that just doesn't go along with
well,
what you want.
In the line of work that I'm in, you know, I can't speak for other people, but oftentimes there's a lot of political pressure,
so
office politics,
yeah.
in terms of like, okay, this person has to weigh in on this project to say,
and we have to listen to this person.
Yeah, this person who has no training whatsoever and has no insight into this process, but like, listen, they're the boss. We have to let them say something. And if they don't say something, then they don't even have what are they there for? They
yeah.
don't even have a job, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's something that a lot of people can relate to. It's a shared frustration among many other people.
It's the art world, yeah. But, you know, gotta appreciate the fact that you're getting paid, so.
Yeah, no, I mean, again.
I want to see, do you have that metal poster? Sorry, I interrupt you.
I'll show you in private sometime.
I want to see, please, yeah.
In private sometime. I'm not particularly proud of it. It was just like a very messy process. Everyone is doing their best, but the reality of it was that it was a lot of time pressure for a huge client. They were doing their best to get it done in time. I never want to work with them again. but the people, again, the people I worked with, I have nothing bad to say about them. It was just a mess.
I see. I really want to see that poster.
Yeah, some other time.
The idea is so silly, it could be very good. Let's see. Are there days that you don't think about art?
I think sometimes. I mean, sometimes you just get caught up in life. I mean, like, you go through a breakup and you're not thinking about art. You're thinking about how to, like, get out of bed in the morning, right?
That's true, yeah.
But I think generally speaking, it's something that really permeates my life, you know? Like, I try to give credence to it every day. I'm, like, trying not to look too much on, you know, Instagram or whatever. But it's, like, hard to avoid looking at other people there because it's so satisfying.
Much, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Right? It's like, I want to see what my friends are up to. I want to see what this, like, one artist in some other part of the world I've never met is up to because they seem to be doing cool stuff. Like, it's just there all the time. It's, yeah. Like, it suffuses your life in a way.
I haven't thought of it, but you're right. I mean, even specifically through that medium, you just, yeah, you see a lot of art. You can't not think about art now, I guess. Especially as an artist, yeah.
That might not mean that you're actively thinking about making something, but I think it's like, oh, wow, this person's really good and I'm really bad. Oh, my God.
The typical, yeah.
It's very, I mean, yeah. That's super normal. There's no one I know who doesn't feel that way sometimes.
Yeah, that's just artist life. Mm-hmm. Do you plan to do more murals?
I would love to do some more murals. I would love to get into Vancouver Mural Fest if I could. I have no idea. Maybe.
Let's sneak you in. Let's find a way.
Oh, man, I would love to do a big mural. I had this idea in my head for the longest time of getting a big blank wall and just drawing, like, a huge figure in black and white with, like, his hands placed so people get a photo op there, you know what I mean?
With hands placed?
I'll have to draw it to you sometime. Yeah. This is not the right medium to communicate it. But I think okay. The idea, like, in reality, like, the way people interact with those murals largely is they, like, get a photo of them.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? So I think you should just play with that idea, like, build something in a space where people really either want to or don't want to be part of the photo and have that conversation about it.
Yeah, yeah. I like that you're embracing it, although I've seen some executions of embracing that idea that are a little too cheesy and in the nose, but
yeah, for sure. Yeah. I think the line you walk is this, like, a stupid gimmick, or is this actually fun? Or if it's a stupid gimmick, how far do you embrace it?
Exactly. So you have to embrace the joke of it. Like, yeah. So yeah, the goofiness of it.
I think that's what makes it fun. So totally. Yeah, I mean, public art is something that is really interesting to me because people are forced to engage with it in a way. Even if it's a background thing for them, like, it's a part of your life.
Exactly.
And you, like, when it's gone, you'll notice it.
And it's definitely sometimes feels like, or to me, when I've done murals, it felt like a responsibility because you are, you know, taking over people's public space.
Mm-hmm.
Really. So, I mean, there is a bit of pressure and, like, are you going to ruin their day or are you going to make it better? Because you can.
Yeah.
If you wanted to, you really could.
Certainly, yeah. I mean, it's not unreasonable to say that, you know, someone's going to look at whatever you make. It doesn't matter what it is, if it's good or bad or anything. And they're going to have an emotional reaction to it that they just don't like it. It reminds them of something, reminds them of a person they don't like, whatever it happens to be. I mean, can you really be responsible for that? I really wonder.
If it was conscious, probably.
Well, that's a different conversation.
You could paint a giant middle finger in a wall.
You can do that if you want. I mean,
and some people are going to be very happy about it too. So,
like, if you want, you can paint a big mural of, like, really discordant colors just to make people unhappy, I guess. Yeah. I'm not going to do that. By the way, Vancouver, I'm not gonna do that.
He's gonna make awesome art. Okay, we can just try to poke some people, try to get you. That'll be really cool. I mean, I don't know where I was gonna say, but you're just very good. So let's make a mural.
Thank you.
Okay, let's see. Last couple of questions before we have to wrap up. Unfortunately, what would you say your biggest failure was?
Oh, it was an artist. I don't know. I didn't really think about that one. I think, generally speaking, the biggest failures are when I don't take a risk on my personal work. If you just retreat back to doing the same thing that you know you can do already, it becomes very mechanical.
It's hard not to.
It's very hard not to. Because it becomes like therapy in a sense. You know, I know how to make pictures this way. I've already done it. I can just do it again. But I don't think that's going to be really satisfying. You know.
What do you say to idea that you have to stay within a certain style so that people can pick up on it and be like, oh, it's this guy?
Yeah, I think that's something that I actually struggle with a lot because it's way easier to form an identity around a particular look, right? This is like, this guy makes this kind of painting, uses these colors,
exactly.
He does this or that, you know, we know we're gonna get if we hire him. We just want you to do your thing, you know, and beyond that, you also can become like a master of a particular idea, exactly, or style, yeah, or whatever. But I also think that it's not for me.
Same. This is why I asked that, because I'm also thinking about this a lot, and it's trying to find ways of force myself into something without it being forced. Okay, that was a bad use of words, but yeah, just finding ways to be consistent without it feeling like it's stagnant.
Well, again, this is that issue of style and voice, right?
Like, yeah, exactly. Yeah, actually, yeah, that's it.
Like the voice will come through if you really think hard about the things you're making, mm-hmm. right? Even if you're not thinking that hard, sometimes it comes through unconsciously anyway.
It's sometimes so accidental. And it's awesome.
Because like, whatever you make is going to, it can't exist outside of you. It's just whatever you have inside of you is going to come out in some particular way using whatever medium. You're going to imprint an idea onto a canvas or a wall or a sculpture or a poem or a song or whatever it happens to mm-hmm. be, you know, and it's unavoidable. I think the thing is you have to be mindful and cultivate that mm-hmm. if you want to take it someplace new.
Very deep.
I guess.
That's very good advice. No, that was awesome. Let's see. No, sorry. That was actually, yeah, I'll have to listen back and check this out. What is one thing that you tell people that they would be surprised to know about you?
That would be me. I guess all four of my grandparents are from different countries, and I don't know how I ended up here, but I really enjoy Vancouver.
That's a good story.
Yeah. So
what countries we got there?
Grandparents on my father's side are Polish and Ukrainian, and they became homesteaders in central Alberta, which is one of the most miserable cold places you'll ever see in your life. My father went to Singapore in the 80s during the oil crash in Alberta. My mother's Chinese, but her father's from mainland China and her mom is from Malaysia. And they had me in Singapore and I was living in Indonesia, and I'm like a 10th culture kid. I don't know where I belong. Or
that's what I was gonna ask. Do you have a pressure of keeping up with all the cultures, or you make your own now?
This is the thing that I think is this is like a sidebar for the art stuff, but it's hard sometimes to know where you belong, because mm-hmm. I go to Singapore, I'm just like a white guy. I go to Alberta and I'm like an Asian dude. And like, there's no,
where's home?
Yeah, there's no home, so I have
Vancouver. Everyone, yeah.
Yeah, I have to decide for myself. I mean, Canada is a very multicultural society. Mm-hmm, it's not like going to, for instance, Japan, which is like a very monolithic sort of place. Mm-hmm. There's like a way to be, for instance, Japanese. We do things this way, we look this way, we dress this way, mm-hmm. we act this way. And again, not to paint too broad a brush, but I think that broadly speaking, there's some truth to that. Whereas in Canada, you know, you run to people from all sorts of backgrounds. You know, I don't expect most people I meet to be, you know, from Vancouver, for mm-hmm. instance, right?
That's the beauty of it. I like it quite a lot that way.
I like it too. I think it's the intermingling of cultures means that you can have a very a broad set of interactions with people who are from all sorts of different places and bring their own ideas into the mix in a way that can be really invigorating.
Cool. And I got the last question for you. What advice would you give your younger self before you went into post-secondary?
Oh, man. Before I went to post-secondary, I think the first one is don't become an engineer, because you're not going to be good at it. But before going to art school, I would say that you just need to keep a really open mind when it comes to other people's work, and mm-hmm. accept that just because something looks cool now does not mean it's like valuable or going to last in the future, right? I mean, something that I think a lot of people struggle with, especially when they're young or in school, is like a groupthink mentality where like, this is what good art looks like. It looks like this one person drawing mm-hmm. this way, you know? It looks like a J.C. Lane Decker painting. I'm not going to shit on that because those are amazing. Yep. But like, it doesn't have to look that way for it to be successful or good.
Is that what you thought?
I think so, yeah. I think it's very... It's hard not to, because, you know, you come across this thing, you're like, this is the pinnacle of good art.
You kind
of
idolize, right?
You know, yeah. Capital G good art, right?
Yeah.
And it's not really a helpful mindset. It's not truthful. And I spent the last 10 years trying to deprogram myself.
Kyle was telling me that you guys were, was it Fuke? Is that Fuchs?
Oh, yeah, Bernie Fuchs.
He was pushed on you guys pretty hard?
Yeah, and I mean, I understand that. I really admire his work as well, but it's like a particular ideal that works for one person. You know, it works for him, and I have to find my own voice and what I think is working.
I guess there's always a problem when people say there's one right way to do it, and yeah.
Yeah, or even like that there is any kind of right way to do it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't think that's really necessarily true.
Yeah. Very nice. Oh man, thank you so much. No, it was really amazing. I feel like I'm quite inspired. I gotta try to figure out who I want to email to see what kind of work I can get. I like that story.
Just email Facebook, see what happens.
Well, do I want? Yeah, let's see. I have to figure out what kind of work I like, and then I'll go from there. There's a first step at the beginning that I gotta
do. Yeah, I mean, I attended a Sagmeister talk in Calgary as well, and you know, his whole shtick was just, why do you expect to have a job if you don't ask for it? Like, that's ridiculous. What kind of ego do you have that you want people to just like knock down your door to work with you?
Very true. No, I just want to collab with something fun. Mm-hmm. Or we're going to go paint some walls. That's what I did this weekend. I was just sending emails to businesses trying to be like, hey, can I paint your wall?
Awesome. Sounds like fun.
Hopefully someone replies. Maybe someone's getting very kind. Mm-hmm. All right, man. That was really amazing. How can people find you and maybe give out the date for the show and location and all that?
Yeah, sure. The best way to get in touch with me is probably through Instagram. My Instagram handle, like you mentioned earlier, is combo_inc. So that's KOM_INC. My show Bastard Tongue is opening June 15th, which is a Friday, I believe, at the James Black Gallery, which is, I think, on
Main and
6th somewhere.
Okay,
there.
Yeah. It's a cool looking house, right?
It's like a weird little laneway. It's really great. Okay. That's a fun little gallery. So
I'm very excited for that one.
Cool.
And then what about Bummer? Bummer Club?
Bummer Club is...
Let's spread that one around, too.
Oh, man.
It's really fun.
Bummer
Check
Club
it out.
Is this bizarre thing I'm running on the side that's just, like, pins and patches and books and whatever weird stuff I have. It's just bummerclub.com. Check it out. I have an Instagram thing for that, too, which I never update, but, you know, come say
it's
hi.
Okay. Yeah, just say hi. Well, ask them to update it, and maybe you'll... Mm-hmm. That's right. So we're just going to put some pressure on you, I think.
Just bother me.
Show more work. Mm-hmm. You're making a lot of really cool work, and... Yeah, thank you so much. Super inspiring. If you also like very good art, I recently, I don't know why I'm doing a shout out because Mr. Ares doesn't need any help, but he's an incredible artist from Spain and he's got a Kickstarter happening right now. He's making a book with all his street artwork. I don't know the guy, but he's just so good. So if you like good art, go get that book. It's I think it's going to be a really special one. Otherwise, if you want to learn more about Creative Theory Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, if you want to say hi or if you know someone who should be on here, who should we chat to and find out all their tricks and secrets, let me know. Otherwise, if you're craving some more art talk next week, Sunday, 2 to 4 p.m., Snackcast, go check it out. Otherwise, thank you so much for listening. I appreciate you. Be back in 2 weeks and have a good day. Thank you. Bye-bye. Mask on my face, 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 mask on my face